So Alessandro is a pleasure to have you, so whenever you want.
Thanks a lot, Luca. So first of all, I'm really glad to be here, and I have this opportunity to present my some aspect of my research activity that, as Luca said before, is on social dynamics on multilayer networks. The target is to get a multi-scale integration based on human-related data. So in order to present myself, so Luca just said something about me. So I'm a research and education network engineer, and my PhD was in Catania, but was with double supervisor. So here in Catania, both, and also here in Cambridge, Department of Computer Science, by Pietro Liò. And Pietro Liò is a professor, I don't know if you know about Pietro, but he's a professor in computational biology, but he has a lot of do with also computer science, complex networks, and so on. And so both my bachelor and master degree were in Catania, and I have some collaboration. These are only two of probably the most strict collaboration that I have now, with Claudio and John at the Side University in Machine Intelligence Research Group, and also with the Professor Social Das, with whom we are working on something related to mobile cloud sensing systems. Probably you can be interested in this. And I'm a visiting research fellow now. So in this talk, I will speak about some motivation behind my work. I will present the methods, so the methodologies that I used during my research, and the data that I used in different contexts, and some of the main concepts. These are like some of the recent works, recent and not so recent works that I will present, obviously only briefly. And so I will also give you, I hope, some interesting insights and some future direction of my research. So basically, my idea is, my field of interest is network science, but I combine network science and so complex networks, multilayer networks, with game theory in order to study social dynamics. The idea is to do this not only in the context of human behaviors, okay, studying, for example, human cooperation, but also in other contexts. For example, we did the work that been published on January this year on process computational biology, and it was about like the social dynamics of chrononutrition. So the idea is that we can apply this approach to different issues. And so the idea is this. Game theory allows me to study and to model the interaction between entities. So the idea is that with the game theory, is it possible to create with the payoff matrix some rules of interactions. And based on these rules of interaction, I can study the evolutionary dynamics. Social multiplex networks in general, so multilayer networks, allows me have a dual role, because from the first side, so from a certain point of view, they allow me to consider different kinds of relationship between agents, users. So the possibility to consider all these encompass the different types of interactions with the interlayer interaction between them. So it's like that we add an extra dimension of analysis, which is that one between layers, not only between the nodes in a single layer. This is really important, for example, in a lot of real-world scenario. For example, in epidemic spreading. So we have applied this multi-scale approach epidemic spreading, we applied in evolutionary dynamics, and in different cases. We have also considered some network properties, such as, for example, entropy and so on, that have allowed us like, to understand which information is encoded in the multilayer networks. So we have probably one of the novelties, of our works has been also to introduce the human-related factors. So the idea is that we introduce some human factors such as homophily, awareness, which are properties of the nodes, so locally affect the behavior of the node, but generally the result in the network could be about evolutionary dynamics, about impacting on the dynamics and the collective behaviors. Through big data mining, we can do, so the multi-layer approach allows us also to do like the cross-modality integration of different kinds of data. So the idea is that with this heterogeneous data, starting from this heterogeneous data, we are able to integrate this data and to analyze a phenomenon from different kinds of view, of perspective. So in terms of motivation, you can see only three simple scenario of interactions between individuals. So for example, online social networks, financial markets, and a sports scenario. And here, some application of my work. So that one is like mosquitoes, because we have applied our models to Zika spreading, Zika virus spreading, which was a real big issue in 2016, and also now there are some cases of Zika all over different countries, and this is a case of, like, this is an example of the helpline in suicide prevention, because one of the work was about suicidal ideation, so the spreading of suicidal ideation, and how is it possible to study the effect of awareness on these cases. This is only an example of cooperation, but obviously natural cooperation in nature that we can observe between ants. That one are two other two pictures representing two other applications. That one is on the idea of chrononutrition of shift workers, so it's an example of junk food. And in that other case, there is the mobile crowd sensing system about reputation score. So the idea in that case was to study how we can design proper incentive mechanism based on behavior of individuals. So in that case, we can leverage on these behaviors and evaluate the peaks of extreme dissatisfaction of users, creating some specific incentive mechanism and increasing the quality of experience. So my approach is both reductionist and holistic. So because, as you know, network science has to do with both the aspect related to the single components, so single nodes, and aspect related more to the network. So we need both approach to analyze a complex network scenario. Some research questions from which all my research activity is based and starts are surely based on multilayer networks, on homophily, and one of the questions at the beginning was the fact that I wanted to study how human cooperation can emerge and sustain a network. The role of multilayer networks was also to describe a real-world scenario. This was the idea. So game theory, all we know about game theory, but it's like two classical definition about the interaction between individuals. The most important thing in game theory is that your outcome depends on the strategies of others. So you are not alone. Yeah, so when you interact with others, you will decide about something not only based on your ideas, but also based on the interaction and your neighbors. This is the father of evolutionary game theory. So John Maynard Smith spoke about the evolutionary form, where rather than looking at the single nodes as rational players, we relax this assumption. And the idea is that of studying the evolution of dynamics, considering that we can imitate, for example, some strategies which have a high fitness. So we high reproductive rate. This is an example of cooperation taking from the painting, famous painting of Vincent van Gogh. It's about there is a Samaritan that is helping the man on the horse. And there are some other two figures that are neglecting the case, so they are not helping anyone. This could be, for example, an idea of human cooperation. So the idea is that when I help someone, the idea is that someone can help me in the future. This is the classical principle of indirect reciprocity. One of the most famous five rules of which are based on human cooperation. So this is some example of multilayer multiplex networks where the idea is to study how non-trivial correlation can emerge between different layers, and they allow also to study dynamic processes. So the idea is that now ICT and also everything in networks is challenging because of its dynamic aspect. So they are now asking us to have models that are able to react adaptively to the changes in the networks. So the idea is that when we should include dynamics, one way to include dynamics is to analyze, for example, multilayer networks, and is also to include game theory. Because in that way, we can analyze at each round of, for example, an iterated prisoner dilemma game, just to do an example, we can analyze which is the evolution, which is how a behavior at a certain time step can evolve in the other one. The idea of dynamics is also important. It is encoded also in the payoff matrix. So sometimes, most classical games, the payoff matrix are fixed. In my case, payoff matrix are dynamics. So the idea is that we can change the payoff based on interaction between nodes. So this interaction may change, for example, the willingness of a node to interact again with the same nodes. These are some methods so that I used. Evolutionary dynamics, so the network science, this is an example of distribution of centrality. And so the last one is about data science and machine learning, because now the idea is to use game theory and reinforcement learning and merging both approach to study how action can be like studied from a multi-layer perspective and using so different types of data and using game theory. So the data that we have analyzed are of different types, so socioeconomic data, social networks, other data from of social contagion, ICT, and so on, metabolic data. And this is some of the concepts that I've described. So this is was one of my first work published in 2015. It was about quantifying the role of homophily. So the idea is to consider the Prisoner Dilemma game. The evolutionary game theory is the framework that we use analytically to study the evolution with Monte Carlo simulation. And we use the Prisoner Dilemma with the assumption of one memory game. That is an assumption valid because of what said Press and Dyson in 2012, that having the memory of the previous play is the same of having the memory of some other play rounds before. Because we are mostly influenced by the previous play, not that before. So, in order to see which was the effect of social ties, we introduced two concepts, or better, we exploited two concepts, that one of critical mass and that one of homophily. Critical mass was defined by Granovetter in 1978, but we used the definition of Centola. So, it's defined as a minimum coalition size, such that if factors organized in these sides, at least these n people will choose cooperation. We modify this definition acting on multilayer. So now we defined a critical mass based on multilayer network. So it's not only a minimum coalition size in a layer, but in the multilayer network. Sometimes some nodes could be excluded by these coalition sides because they are present in one layer. So we cannot consider the same node in different layers because it's the same in a multiplex network. Probably I didn't say anything very important. In multiplex network, the interaction are between only one node and the other nodes, but the other nodes are replica of the same nodes. So it's not interaction like in multilayer that you can have with the different nodes, but it's with the same node. So it's like a self-interaction. This is the centrality we use like the game vector-like centrality, and a new definition that I will show you, which involves also the concept of homophily. I think that is the next one. Yeah. So this is the mathematical formulation of multilayer. Here we include also the homophily matrix. Basically, the homophily matrix is based on this parameter. This parameter is like a measure of distance between nodes. So it's like that we are measuring homophily based on the distance, which is the result of the frequency of interaction between nodes in the network. So the more frequent two nodes interact, the more similar they will behave. This is the basic assumption. From this assumption, we define this homophily matrix. And we merged it with the definition of the eigenvector-like centrality. So we derived the global heterogeneous eigenvector-like centrality and homophily of the multiplex, which is defined as follows here. This is the overall centrality and homophily measure that we can have for each node in the network. Using a scale-free network as a network substrate, because it's, as you know, is like the most adopted scenario for social networks, we analyzed the evolutionary dynamics using the Fermi function, but we introduced two factors. The scaling factor at x is about the communicability measure. So it measures like the, it's a measure that was defined by Estrada and Gomez-Gardner, but we redefined it considering the centrality and homophily matrix that I defined before. So the idea is that to measure, which is the coupling effect and the interlayer interdependence between two layers based on the works that connect a node E to a node J, but considering also the neighborhood of these nodes. So if a node E could interact also only with its replica in the other layer have a different neighbor, as a different neighbor. So this different neighborhood can obviously change the behavior of the single node. For this reason, we introduced the scaling factor in this case. And there is also the homophily denominator of the exponential function. So what about the results? The finding were that this is the case of in high homo or low homophily, and this is the case with high homophily. As you can clearly see, in the case of high homophily, we have a faster emergence of cooperation. This is almost due to the fact that so homophily like align the strategies of nodes at a certain point, but obviously you can see that we have this evolution after 70 rounds. So the idea is that obviously in a certain sense homophily is able to act as a catalyst toward cooperation, because so it's like a force that creates between nodes the willingness to cooperate with the others. Probably most important, most significant is also these results in terms of microscopic evolution. Because as you can see, in the so correspondingly, in the low homophily case and the high homophily case, the evolution of cooperation occurs year after only, so year after 50 time step. In that case, only after 20 time step. So it's really quicker rather than the other case. And we have the overall cooperation of the network, in this case, only at time step 70. So the group size, and also so the it's quicker, and also the group size is more, as you can see here. The idea of studying social dynamics and a similar model, but with some other definition and statistical estimator, was used also for this work on process computational biology. So the modeling part of metabolic modeling was the work made by Claudio Angione and his group at the said university. My work was on social dynamics. The idea was to quantify the bidirectional interplay between dietary behaviors that emerge from the social network and the gut microbial composition. For the first time, so we had a model where methodologically we create a correlation between what we eat and how we behave in the network, in a social network. The idea is that our social behaviors will change our gut microbial composition, and also our gut microbial composition will change after our way of feeling and so behaving with the others. For this reason, we define a gut human behavior axis, which is something that has to do also with the gut brain axis. So the idea is that now there is a lot of work on gut brain axis. About a lot of physicians are working on this because inflammation is one of the most important causes obviously of cancer and so on. So studying also this aspect, in our opinion, is really important because chrononutrition and also so the meal timing can act and can create, for example, in children, can help in a certain sense for non developing some disorders like autism disorders. So in this sense, gut microbiota is really essential to evaluate. Now, so in these cases, we introduced two other statistical estimators. One was based on gut bacteria similarity. What we did basically was this: we considered 100 diets. 100 diets, where these diets were about different kinds of shift workers. So we considered only shift workers. So these are vulnerable population, obviously. In World Health Organization defines this type of workers as like ill. So it's a type of disease being shift working for a long period. The idea is that gut similarity is based on the gut profiles that are built based on their diets. Sometimes the diet is similar to a Western diet, but there are some perturbations on this diet. This perturbation will change our gut microbial composition. And over the time, we analyze how the change of gut microbial composition will change also our attitude towards the other human users. So the unconscious bias that we include are about microaffirmation and micro inequities. The concept, I think, is it should be here. No, it's the next slide. Okay. So macroaffirmation and macro inequities, I can define here. Yes, is here. So it's about it's a concept that was defined by Rowe, he's a professor at MIT, and defined these apparently small events that can be considered like unconscious biases that we have and that can modify our behaviors. So the idea is that even slightly we can modify with these small acts our behaviors, because we are like a little bit more happy or a little bit more sad about something. For example, when we have when we eat and we are with other people, sometimes even an exchange of opinion or an exchange of expression can change our attitude towards food. So we can change also, in a certain sense, our diet. Obviously, changing diets are in a long time span. We cannot analyze it like in a really short time span. The idea is to include this, and we consider so this factor also in the strategy adoption process, which is ruled also in this case by Fermi function, and is in that factor here. So, starting from this kind of evolution, the idea was to analyze what was the density of cooperators. In this way, we can analyze, we can quantify how much, in a certain sense, our interaction modify our dietary behaviors. Then we have introduced this control mechanism. So as I told you before, the idea is to study the interplay. So to study the interplay, we need a control mechanism that can change then and update the gut profiles based on these parameters. The happiness index counts the number of cooperation of each node during the different rounds. So N with R is like the number of rounds that we are considering. After a certain number of rounds, we'll have this control mechanism. And so we update diets, gut profiles, and we consider the new evolution. These are satisfaction bias that are derived from the Magra affirmation, so that if we have a high number of positive bias, the idea is that we are probably not willing to change our diet. On the opposite, if we have a lot of negative bias, we can be more prone to change our diet. Obviously, we should evaluate it in really long time span. So, what about gut similarity? A, B, C, D are like the different windows, time windows that we analyzed for four feedbacks. And this is the composition of guts, so the gut similarity between nodes in the network, in the different layers. We analyzed two layers. This obviously leads to a reclustering of the network. So we have, this is like the before the feedbacks, before the after the first feedback, after the second, and after the third feedback from the network. The evolution dynamics obviously is mixed. As you can see, there are a lot of fluctuation strategies. The problem was that if at the beginning it seems that in a certain sense people are prone to cooperate, so to share their good habits, to improve their diets, it's like they are pushed towards improving their diets, then obviously they go to a state which is in a certain sense more like chaotic, probably, because there is like a fluctuation of strategies. These results are due to the fact that this fluctuation is based on the fact that we have analyzed for a certain number of rounds, but as you know, to have this great adaptation, we need more rounds to analyze it. For this reason, this period, we are also asking for some data, biological data, to analyze more diets and in a longer period, because in this case, we need longitudinal data. In another work, we analyzed the impact of heterogeneity and awareness, so in modeling epidemic spreading. The original fact was to introduce the coevolution of the two processes, because a lot of epidemic spreading models study only like SIR or SIR-like epidemics. In our case, we analyzed two SIR-like epidemics. The first one was the virus, so the spreading of Zika virus. The other spreading processes was about awareness. The idea is that, as I can show you, I think is here, yes. There is like the coevolution of both, where S is like the heterogeneous susceptibility. IP is the preventive isolation. E is infected, R is recovered. And this is the other process, the process of awareness, where there is unaware node, aware node, faded node. Faded node means that this node, after a certain point, there is a cognitive limit. And then our awareness will decrease over the time about a phenomenon. So in a certain sense, we will be more prone to like forget about it, okay? This is a cognitive limit of human people, and we have included this also in our model. So the aspect that we have included is the fact that susceptibility is heterogeneous. It's heterogeneous because we define awareness. So the susceptibility towards a phenomenon depends obviously on our awareness. So in the multiplex network, we define the infection rate and these heterogeneous factors is present obviously in the infection rate. Obviously, it's only like an estimation of this rate. And as you can see here, there is like the entropy of each node in the network. Starting from this aspect, we analyze this is another factor. So the susceptibility, this is based only on awareness. This is also based on the socioeconomic factor, because as you can imagine, when we have like a predisposition to behave in a certain way, it depends also on our socioeconomic condition. So based on socioeconomic condition, obviously the idea of spreading of Zika could change a lot. And also we used some data about socioeconomic condition of different countries. This is only to show the heterogeneous distribution of the infection rate, and these with green are the nodes that we decided to isolate. Why we decided to isolate some nodes? Because preventively, before that epidemics could grow up, we decided to preventively isolate those nodes who were central and with less awareness. So obviously they're the most vulnerable. The density of infected nodes over time, so decay thanks to awareness. But as you can see, the number of infected nodes depends obviously on the economic health of the nodes. So the best case is that one related to high recovery rate and low fading rate, which is that one. Because obviously we have an high recovery rate of Zika and a low fading rate, so our attention remains over the time. In the phased diagram, we can now show that with green is like the epidemic outbreak. With orange is our epidemic outbreak due to the coevolution of two processes. As you can see, our epidemic outbreak is a little bit higher than the other one. It means that in a certain sense, our preventive isolation strategies and awareness are allowing us to increase this epidemic outbreak. This could allow us to have like a window, a temporal window, where we can do some prevention strategies, for example. And for some countries with a lower socioeconomic factor, we can act in order to prevent the diffusion of the virus. This could be the idea. So these are different countries with a different socioeconomic condition, this awareness, infection rate. This is the expected infection rate based on data. We have like compared with a data-driven approach, so we have compared what happened in this country, taking this data from World Health Organization, to what we have with our, so probably I don't show it. Okay, there is like I showed like the comparison between our model and the data analysis, and we have a perfect matching between them. You can see in the paper. In this other work, the idea was to use a similar model, but introducing also another aspect, which is the so-called overlapping awareness, and this is about suicide. So in this case, the idea was to, as I mentioned before, to study how suicidal ideation can spread all over the network, but which could be the impact of having an overlapping awareness in a certain sense curbing the effect of suicidal ideation. Most often, suicidal ideation is due to like a better effect, or also called the copycat effect. As you know, for example, when there was the famous suicide of Kurt Cobain, there was like a waves of suicide in Seattle. So these waves of suicide can be really dangerous because it can involve also a population which is wider than only the neighborhood. So in order to avoid this diffusion of this social contagion phenomena, we have analyzed which could be the role of overlapping awareness. The overlapping awareness, as the term suggests, is an awareness related to other words, in this case, or to other like aspects, which are related to the main social contagion phenomenon. For example, if we are speaking about the suicide of, we used the data of Robin Williams suicide. So Robin Williams suicide, but we are speaking about people who were really vulnerable. So they started searching a lot on Google about suicide and about what could be the causes of suicide. The interesting result is this. Now I will show you the result. So this is like the, so the weighted in our network are homophily and the gradient of awareness between nodes. This is also the concept of homophily. Okay, we define a different matrix. So this is the overlapping awareness. The awareness on correlated issues. So the idea is this. If you see A, when you exceed in information on issues positive correlated to the contagion, this can encourage the contagion. So if you search a lot about something related to that suicide event, for example, and for example, we analyzed some Google search with Google Trends of words that were related to the word suicide. So suicide prevention, suicide causes, all these words in this semantic. And when we analyzed all these words, obviously we choose those words that were more related and more strictly correlated with suicide, with the term suicide. Not only this, but it was one of the heterogeneous types of data that we used. We discovered that we found out that if you search a lot on these issues, which are positively correlated, the idea is that you encourage the contagion. You are not curbing it. So it's the opposite. And when nodes attention in that case in B, for example, okay, it fades quickly over the time, obviously also the effect of correlation vanishes. Because there is also in this case the idea of attention. The attention of the other topic could have a fading, you know, could fade over the time. Obviously fades over the time. If it's really quick, the effect is almost impossible to neglect. So it's like quite the same. In the last case, we have a scarce interest in the main contagion. And so the curve, you can see that positive correlation at the end is more. Also in this case, so we used this type of data. So the rate of awareness, infection rate, and the overlapping awareness. And in particular, we use like Google search on the term suicide and suicide prevention. And also, there is probably, okay, I don't know. There is also a classification that we used. It was about Bishop. So people were characterized at the beginning with an awareness on the concept of suicide based on some classes. These classes allow us like to build the awareness in our network, the initial awareness, and we have some cluster of awareness. So people fall in one of these clusters. This is so the idea of an NLP framework where we have so people, processes, analysis of these processes with multiple social networks and so on, and based on data, we have the target is to analyze these large scale phenomena, such as social contagions. But the idea of Internet of People is that we should design everything based on people's needs and the requirements. So in this way, we can really create a model that is based on people and targeted on them. So this is some conclusion about that model. It was about the fact that the importance of awareness and the importance of considering both aspects in coevolution in the network. I don't know how much time.
You can tell me, just 10 minutes.
It's okay. Yeah. Okay, so in this case, it was like a work for a workshop that we present in Social Sense on February, being in Montreal. So the idea was to present this improving of quality of experience based on multi-layer social sensing and a cognitive architecture and game theoretic model. So now I will show you something. Okay, this was like the motivation behind the work. So the idea of cyber physical convergence, the idea of Internet of People. So everything should be data centric, but also people centric. And so this is like the idea of cyber social world, which is connected with the physical social world. So data from the physical social world and then actions. The problem is this one. So the trustworthiness of mobile cloud sensing application depends on the quality and quantity of data of contribution. Not only on the quantity, because if you are, for example, a user that exploits a lot of services, but without giving quality contribution, because of for example, your smartphone is giving not the right values, in that moment, your contribution are totally useless. And you are also decreasing the quality of experience of the other users. So the importance of the quality of contents is included in this model, QMQ model, that was about social DAS and we published in 2017. We started from three classes of users: honest, selfish, and malicious. Quantity is the degree of participation, quality is the accuracy of contribution. So we create this at the beginning, so we have this rating feedback mechanism, and we have the quality of information, which is the metric that we use at the beginning. So this is a way only to like represent, is taken from this work of Sajal. So there are the honest people, selfish and malicious. As you can see, the score in terms of reputation obviously is higher for the honest people, it's lower obviously for the malicious ones. The idea is that here we use the multi-layer social sensing and the cognitive architecture. And we included also in this case a control mechanism. So now I can, this is the multi-layer social sensing. So we have different services. So it's a double multi-layer because it's a multi-layer based on services, different services where we are contributing. It's also a multi-layer based on users. So because users could be socially connected. The aggregate layer obviously like aggregates all this information present in the multi-layer social sensing. The idea is that starting from the classification of citizens into the different classes that I showed you before, we create a social network of citizens. We define weights based on homophily and awareness. Homophily in this case is the similarity of services that we use, okay? We consider the social multiplex, weighted multiplex network of citizens, and we analyze this interaction using a social dilemma. In particular, we use the Snowdrift game. The choice of Snowdrift game was due to the fact that it is the most realistic way to model the scenario where even if I decided to contribute and the other one doesn't do it, I have an advantage. The advantage is from my data, obviously. So this evolution dynamics, so with the microaffirmation and micro inequities, that in this case could be related to the fact that also we can have like some bias, unconscious biases, when we are, for example, think about like a traffic monitoring service. At a certain point, you put some data. If you have not like the right condition of the traffic, you will be like unsatisfied, obviously, because you are putting a lot, you are giving a lot of data, but you have not the service functioning well. So this could create some peaks of extreme dissatisfaction. We introduced a control mechanism that measures this satisfaction bias and give some social rewards, so some rewarding adaptively changing over the network to some nodes that we consider like the most good contributors in the network, both in terms of quantity and quality. This allow us, this allowed us to increase this is the game theoretic model, to increase this community function, define it. Okay. To increase the reputation score, because as you can see, if at the beginning, based on our data, so the quantity and quality was the reputation score was really low, then it was mixed, but surely it was a little bit overall, it was a little bit higher, no? As you can see. We only used the 100 drones, so it's really, so we need more data also in this case. But it was useful only to understand how we can like improve the quality of contribution. Okay, it's like a self-healing of the network, and what we have, so it's a multi-scale integration learning method based on people. Okay. Obviously, we want to validate the efficacy of this architecture also using some real data set in crowd sensing application scenario. And we are working on this, and now we are going to submit something in December in Honors-EVA, another journal. Okay, this is, for example, this is the idea that we are now going to submit in the special issue of Versailles, and this is about, so, starting from the dynamics pattern of connectivity and of this, the classical multi-layer social sensing that I presented before, we analyze the different possible effects, so the defection, cooperation, coexistence of cooperation defection, but based on network heterogeneity. So we have included here different kinds of network, measuring which is the impact of heterogeneity. And this is like the way to design a core of a DSS, or the decision support systems for users. This is another platform that you have, we have submitted and now is under review on AWE transaction on cognitive and communication networking. It's about like a social multiplex modeling for D2G communications. Using the same context of social contagion that I presented in the case of suicide, in this case we define a new score, which is like this one, the ETA score. So it's about the shared content, which depends on the number of interactions. So this one are the useful information, that one are the useless. If we count the useless and the useless information, we have like this ratio. This ratio is about so that the how the contents are more positive or so useful or useless. Based on this, we can, for example, try to analyze which could be the effect of a bias-fired control mechanism, which is based on this non-heterogeneity in terms of information, and tune the awareness and alertness on the whole multiplex network. The bias-fired control mechanism increases the nodes' awareness of the information, and the idea is to break the echo chambers effect, because sometimes, when we, for example, have a lot of information that we include, we introduce in the network, this information could be not useless, so not useful, so useless information. When this information are a lot, we can create some echo chamber effect that you know about misinformation. Some of the results that now we are going to, so now, obviously to, hopefully to publish, is about so the, how the structural heterogeneity of network can impact on this dissemination of fake news. And as we can see, in this diagram, we have like a measured density here, where XX represents like the dissemination of information. So in this case, the dissemination of information is more on a higher values, which means that here we have a lot of useless information. Here we have a little bit less the effect of echo chambers. This is the basic aspect so to design in our application domain use case was about healthcare in this case for ambient assisted living. So we can like use this model to have an IOP based deep learning based on this data dissemination. So improve data dissemination based on awareness. This is another work that now we have is just accepted from for a conference in India. And this is about like using also the multi-layer approach for blockchain in case of two conflict scenario of blockchains. So the idea is that using this type of approach and is mixed between heuristic and game theory. So the idea is that using at the beginning heuristics in order to have a generative model, it's like a plugin model. Then with this, based on this heuristic, we can use game theory to align or to modify strategies based on which are the behaviors of users in this case. Obviously, we're speaking about blockchain. The idea at the end is to have a platform for modeling this conflict and measuring the role of heuristic and homophily. So, to putting it together, we can say that the multi-layer approach so allow to have this cross-modality integration and having like a multi-scale learning method. Using it with the human-related phenomena and so analyzing macro, mesoscale, and microscale properties of this phenomena, we can surely find out some interesting findings about multi-layer networks and behaviors on this network. Homophily has a striking role, for example, in the case of evolution of human cooperation, and also awareness, we have seen that could have an important role, a key role in particular in social contagion. The game theoretic approach allows us to deal with these small units of interaction and change payoff matrix dynamically in order to see which is the effect of this interaction over the time. Obviously, one of the most important future work is to validate the efficacy of what I presented using more real dataset, but really big, in particular that one on chrononutrition, for example, and also on mobile cloud sensing system. And design this mechanism. So the idea now is also I'm working on dynamic aspects of so building payoff that are dynamic based on network and based on obvious interaction between nodes. So the dynamicity is not only on the payoff, but also the type of game. So the game may change over the time. It's like a multi-game perspective where we have different games, one after the other. And they can allow me to understand better which could be, for example, the effect of a particular specific window rather than another one, where we have different games. Now I'm working in the department about with other PhD students on reinforcement learning and game theory. So the idea is to define new rules and policies and adaptive rewards, defining dynamic rewards that adaptively change for each agent in the network due to the reinforcement learning strategy. Okay, these are only some citations about Martin Novak and Dobansky, so about evolution and about the equation of life. And so these are some publications that you can check out about my work. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Alessandro. Thank you. So I'm just going to stop here.